My eggs are back there somewhere.
Wave to the eggs.
There's a growing trend in the United States. More and more women are freezing their eggs.
I think in the last 2 years alone, I've had 10 to 12 friends that have gone through the process. It gives me options in the future, and I think it's exciting. I mean, technology enables this to happen, where you didn't have that option 10, 20 years ago.
Simmons shared her egg freezing journey on social media, showing how, despite its recent popularity, the process is still very involved and very expensive.
I believe this was my bed right here.
Luckily, a handful of startups are trying to change that. As one of the only two female venture capitalists at her firm, Simmons realized she could help. And as more investors have experiences like hers, the startups are seeing more funding.
I believe in the next year, there'll be a lot more innovation in women's health in general. And there are more and more entrepreneurs in the last year that I've seen that are trying to tackle different parts of the pie, so to speak, with women's health.
Once a solution designed solely for women who might struggle to conceive because of serious medical conditions like cancer, egg freezing is now a mainstream elective process.
You typically have to do between 2 and 4 injections a night in your stomach. It was a process. So I share the ups and downs of the journey, the time commitment. You know, some days I didn't want to do any more injections. I hate needles.
After 2 weeks of these hormone injections, which are meant to stimulate the ovaries to ripen multiple eggs, the woman undergoes transvaginal surgery under sedation. A needle with a suction device attached is entered through the vaginal wall and into the ovarian follicle to retrieve the eggs, which are then immediately frozen. In 2012, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine stopped classifying it as an experimental procedure.
I think there were 7 retrievals the day that I did mine.
As a result, the industry has grown 14 times in the last decade. In 2009, only 500 women underwent egg freezing cycles. In 2016, there were 9,000 cycles, and that number is much higher today. And that means big business. U.S. fertility clinics generated $1.9 billion in revenue in 2017. Now startups are popping up everywhere.
There should be more capital invested in women's health companies. And if you look at healthcare in general, a lot of, you know, from medicine to the studies, they've been based on men. If you look at tampons, for instance, they're originally designed during the war for wounds, and then it transferred into something for women. And there hasn't been a lot of innovation just in that in the last hundreds of years. So the more that women are thinking about, how do I rethink this product? Like, why is it this way? How could it be better?
Simmons is part of a boom in investment in women's health, a global market projected to reach $50 billion by 2025. The majority of investments are early stage deals like those Simmons is pursuing, a few hundred thousand or a million here and there. But in all, $500 million was raised by startups in 2018, up from $350 million 5 years ago. Despite the money pouring into the market, egg freezing is still too expensive for most women. One cycle can cost between $13,000 and $15,000.
Those little black dots are the starting follicles.
Extend Fertility has cut costs for women by streamlining the process. Its New York clinic is unusual because it's solely dedicated to egg freezing, with a lab on site. Most clinics include other costly fertility treatments like in vitro fertilization. In 2018, Extend did more than 1,000 egg freezing cycles at their clinic alone. The high number of clients allows them to bring down the cost for each cycle by about 50% to $5,500. Another way to bring down the cost is for employers to cover it, and that's become a big trend in big tech. Facebook and Apple started offering the benefit in 2014 to somewhat of an uproar. Critics argued the company wanted to keep its female employees from having babies, ensuring more time in the office.
The request came from the employees. This was not a top-down, we want you to stay at your desk. It was actually just from women who they're working hard to recruit and retain, saying, hey, listen, we need a benefit.
2/3 of millennials will change their job for better fertility benefits.
Schlanger's startup Progeny works to get more companies on the bandwagon, helping them attract top talent by providing fertility coverage. With 1 in 8 women struggling with fertility, he says the need is big.
women are waiting longer and longer to have children. For the first time in history last year, the birth rate for 30 to 34 year olds exceeded the birth rate for 25 to 29 year olds. And as women wait longer to have children, the incidence of infertility grows.
Studies show that 80% of women choose to freeze their eggs because they're waiting to find the right partner to have a baby with, not because they're focused on their career. Today, Schlanger says that approximately 25% of large employers provide some level of fertility coverage. Google, Yahoo, Uber, Microsoft, to name a few. Another big barrier for women hoping to freeze their eggs? It's time-consuming and cumbersome. Startup Kindbody has set up mobile clinics in San Francisco, Los Angeles, and New York, where women can get some basic testing done to tell them if they should freeze their eggs. The AMH test these women are lined up for is a reading of the hormones and ovarian reserves that give a general indication of fertility.
And then when those results come back, you're just empowered. Knowledge is power. So whether or not you choose to freeze your eggs today, not at all, in 5 years, you now are equipped with a tremendous amount of data and confidence.
The biggest advancement in egg freezing came in the early 2000s, when slow cooling of the eggs was widely replaced with vitrification, a flash freezing process that reduces the chance of damaging ice crystals forming on the eggs. One cycle used to yield one or two viable eggs. Now it yields 10 to 12. Even with vitrification, freezing is nowhere close to a guarantee. Only 14% of cycles later thawed for fertilization and implantation result in a live birth.
The Pacific Fertility Center in San Francisco says a piece of storage equipment lost liquid nitrogen for a brief period on March 4th.
And last year, two major facility centers had freezer failures that resulted in the loss of thousands of eggs. To better the chances of pregnancy, Kindbody is developing an online data analyzing system to predict how many egg freezing cycles each woman would need for the number of children she wants.
Let's solve it with AI. Let's get a predictive algorithm. You know, if you're 32 or you're 35 and your pregnancy history is this and your AMH level is this, you look like other 32-year-olds, whether they're sitting in Houston or Chicago or New York. And so with that knowledge, again, you would build an automated algorithm for complete transparency into success rates.
Some women fall off of that fertility cliff in their 20s. Some women don't fall off of it until their 40s. So we have to personalize it.
Startup Cellmatics developed a genetic test to predict what your success rate will be.
Some women are aware that maybe their mothers went into early menopause or had difficulty conceiving. But unfortunately, for many of us, our mothers had babies much younger than us. So we don't have the information on what that would have looked like for our family history if they had waited until their 30s or 40s to start their families.
One in 50 women has the gene for early onset menopause, which means they would need to freeze their eggs at a much younger age. Cellmatics Fertilome test allows women to take a spit test at home or a blood test with their doctor to test for these genes.
I was actually one of the first people who used our genetic test. What I found was that I had inherited a genetic risk factor for premature menopause. And I think of the decisions I would have made a little bit differently when I was in my 20s if I had known that my clock was ticking a bit faster than the average woman.
Dr. Beim fast-tracked a pregnancy plan, having three healthy children in 5 years.
We also need to be pushing the envelope and thinking about why in 2019, when we know so much about the biology of how the ovary functions, why don't we have drugs that can help a woman actually extend her ovarian function? We have drugs for heart failure. Why don't we have drugs for ovarian failure?
Cellmatics' next phase, a biosciences division to work on just that.
I think when women are taking contraceptives, the contraceptive should be spiked with a drug that helps preserve their ovarian function. If they're delaying childbirth, they should be also preserving their ovarian functions.
Simmons is seeing more startups run by women like Dr. Byrne with fertility stories of their own.
And so personally, through going through this, I'm passionate about rethinking this for women altogether. So it's a better experience and it's easier for women and there's more information out there in the world about it.
The future of reproductive health on the female side, at least, is that a woman in her first OBGYN visit will get a full panel of tests. She will know what her risk factors are. She'll be offered egg freezing or ideally even a drug that can help her in a more natural way extend the function of her ovary into the future. And she'll look back on our time in absolute horror and say, I can't believe that you all just waited and hoped it would work out for the best. And so these are tools we can build. It's science that we have. We're really just missing the dollars to build these companies and build this future for women.